7 a.m. outdoors, weather permitting, And then, of course, the traditional service with brass on the 21st, so we hope to see you take advantage of these worship opportunities. And of course, next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and that begins all of Holy Week. Quick note about Holy Week, our paper recycler, see, it makes it even better, our paper recycler is offering bonus money for more paper. So if you've got paper to recycle, save it for next week or put it in there as soon as you can. Between the 14th and the 20th, that's when they will are offering a bonus there. So that's important to note. Pastor Heidi has a quick announcement about April 9th, the interfaith field trip.
If you are going to the Seder with me, please meet at the church parking lot at 5:30 so we can head out together. If you're comfortable, you don't need a ride, and you would prefer to just go straight there on your own, please write that on the back of your card so I'm not standing here going, where is she? She's late. So one way or the other, we will be here meeting at 5:30 to carpool and caravan.
Thank you, Pastor Heidi. And then one more quick announcement. The Diaconate Wing Night is Friday, May 3rd. So just a little ways off, a little less than a month away. And that is a wonderful, fun time. And they are asking for donations of theme baskets, which are so fun to put together, to raffle off. So if you're thinking about doing a theme basket, there will be a sign up. And also tickets will be on sale. Follow the service with Jen Berry. And there she is waving at you in that adorable chevron outfit. Does anyone else? Oh, Ken, yes.
Yeah, I want to remind you folks about the CD we're producing here. It's called Love and Tranquility. It's going to be primarily Native American flute and the keyboards, but there'll be a few other things in there. It's a real church effort. And there's something in your insert here about it and how you can order it. If you get a chance, we appreciate ordering it as soon as possible so we know how many CDs we should order, and they're being produced right now.
And I want to mention that 30 copies have already been reserved just on the back of attendance cards last week. So if you have not already reserved your CD copy, please write it on the back of your attendance card. Just write CD. Put your name on the front, though. We had somebody not do that. Just wrote CD and wrote who? We don't know. So do that. Pop it in the offering plate with your attendance card, and we'll get that reserved for you.
Also, at the prayer response today, in lieu of the fourfold amen, you'll hear a track, Tranquility, from that today. So
I'm excited about
that. Will be the prayer response today.
Thank you, Tom. Any other announcements to come before the congregation? Let's be in a spirit of prayer and worship as we continue with our service.
She's done. So we come over here.
Thank you. please stand in body or spirit for the call to worship? We come to this place because we want to know God.
God who helps us set aside the past and walk the path to new life.
We come in these moments because we want to know Jesus.
Who anoints us with the resurrection and shares our lives with us.
We come to be with one another because we want to know the Spirit.
Who shapes us for life with God so we may praise God forever.
Sing together hymn number 655, Sanctuary, and we'll sing it through two times.
Consider the things of old. I am about to do new things. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers and deserts. The wild animals will honor it, the jackals and the ostrich, for I give water in the wilderness, river in the desert, to give drink to my close people, the people whom I form for myself, so that they might declare my praise.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Ah, 'tis spring, when all the squirrels in the neighborhood's thoughts blindly turn to... all the squirrels this morning. We must have hit five squirrels almost on our way down here. They're going crazy. Do we have any first-time visitors? Like Irene said, there are so many familiar faces come back that we haven't seen in a long time. Anyone here for the first time? Well, you're all welcome, as we are glad that you are here. I was planning on having to give an update on Karen Morgan, and then she zipped through this morning looking great. But she is doing well. She's out of the hospital. That's the main thing. Sam, what's Sam's last name?
Kyler,
Laura Rung's son, is still at Metro. But yesterday they were able to remove the vent, and he's doing okay. So as Laura said, baby step, baby step, baby step. And that's where he is and how he's doing. So who else do we bring this morning before the Lord?
A prayer for all those churches that were burned, and that people would stop hating people so much.
Amen. Yes, there were, three or four churches in Birmingham that were torched, and they are suspicious fires.
Mm-hmm.
Yesterday I got to go to the zoo for, I got to go to the zoo for scavenger hunt at Albany. Forgot what where I went.
That was the Columbus Zoo, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a great zoo. That was fun. Go ahead, Judy.
I have a joy. The music we've had already this morning is so amazing. Thank you to our music.
I just have a quick update. I told you a few weeks ago about my friend Kim. You guys have been kind of following her. She has breast cancer, but she had been in the hospital. They looked at her skin and the cancer went to her lungs. However, what we found out later was that she actually had a lung infection, turned into a life-threatening case of pneumonia, but her medical team found the treatment that worked. She went home a week and a half later. She's doing really well, and cancer has not spread to her lungs. It's still no evidence of disease, so.
Excellent.
This is amazing.
Yeah. Excellent. Thank you for sharing that. Let's see. Go ahead, Chris.
I see Len Lane here, and I just want to welcome him back. And I see Barb and Dennis and all the people, so yeah, happy to see you guys.
Yes. Good to see you. Cheryl, go ahead.
Joy Anna. The joy is for our grandson Carson's arrival on March 26th. We just went to visit them, and they're doing well. The concern is for our daughter Dakota. She's having back surgery on Thursday. For scoliosis, they're putting a rod in her spine. So she'll be in the hospital about 3 days.
And she's the one that's getting her?
Yes.
So there's another joy. Thank you, Cheryl. Ken?
This is a joyful announcement on behalf of two modest parents, Jim and Sharon Heinrich's daughter, Lisa, who was named the Teacher of the Year for Medina County Schools.
Jim, go ahead back there, Linda, and then we'll go upstairs.
I wanted to mention that it was great to see Ken Lane back with us today, and also to mention that Ginger Waffle's here with us, too, after a long illness.
You know, I'm so glad you didn't come back last week when I was preaching about the prodigals. So I'm so glad to see Len and Ginger and everybody that's back. Wow. Jim, get over there to Ginger while we go upstairs.
I have a joy that every day of our life this month is getting closer to Easter.
There you go. There you go. But don't wish your life away too much. That bothers us old people. Thank you. Go ahead, Ginger.
I just want to thank everyone for their thoughts and their prayers. The many cards I got and the phone calls, it really meant the world to me. Thank you, everyone.
We are just so glad to see you up close and personal this morning, and it's really great to have you back. Last call. Oh, and Tiffany is back with Everett. Yay! Let's pray together. Lord God, we give you thanks for the beauty of this spring day and the many, many, many people who have come back to join us in worshiping you. God, we simply ask that you hear our prayers, both our joys and our concerns. We know that even when the answer may not be apparent, you are listening and you are with us, whatever is going on. God, it gives us great joy to see the many ways you have been working in the lives among us with Kim and with Ginger and with Len and with the babies and the many things that are going on that just remind us of your holy presence in this place. It is wonderful to be here to celebrate you as spring commences. Lord, we give you thanks in all we do. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Wow, thank you, choir. Wow. Oh, children. Come, come, come. We gotta stay down in front of the communion table. My goodness. So many children, what a great problem to have. I wonder if there are maybe, oh, could I have two brave adults who would want to come in case we need some help? Somebody's crying out for Tony. Are you going to be the brave adult? Tony and Serena. All right. Okay, so tell me, we have five senses. Name them for me. Christopher, one.
Taste.
Summer, two.
Touch.
Sight. Richard, three.
Touch.
Oliver, you got one? Smell. And what's the fifth one? Hearing. Yeah. So here's a weird question for you, but if you had to give up either being able to see, being able to hear, being able to touch, being able to smell, or being able to taste, which one would you give up? Which one, yes? Smell. 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 Yeah, we really kind of think we don't use our noses as much as we use all those other senses. So I thought this morning we'd put your noses to good use and see how they're working. So there's a different smell in each of these, and after you smell it, yeah, I know it looks brown, but it's not what you're thinking. Shame on you, Autumn. Take a sniff and don't say what it smells like, okay? Smells like?
Vanilla.
Vanilla, you're right. Does that remind you of anything? You just had a vanilla drink in the car? Chapstick. What does it remind you of, Riley? Ice cream. Good answers. Okay, let's do another one.
You don't like
Okay.
Is it not?
What do you think it smells like?
A dryer sheet.
A dryer sheet? It does kind of smell a little like a dryer sheet. What do you think, Tilly? Tilly, what do you think? Soap? What do you think, Ollie? Oliver?
Laundry detergent.
Laundry detergent? Reminds you of baby oil, Gabby? Dawn soap, Richard?
Candles.
This, if you go smell my husband, it's aftershave. After he shaves, he puts it on like perfume. So this is Aqua Velva. There's something about an Aqua Velva man. You wear Aqua Velva too? There you go. I wanted to do that because this morning the story that the grown-ups are going to hear about from the Bible talks about fragrances and talks about how powerful they can be as a reminder. So for me, smelling that last one reminds me of my husband, and it also kind of reminds me of my father because he smelled like that too. So fragrances can have very powerful effects on your memory. Like, you know, you talk about somebody drinking a water bottle full of vinegar. That's a powerful memory. So, you know, we don't always appreciate our sense of smell, but without it, things would not be the same. So let's pray. God, we give you thanks for most of the smells in the world. And we are grateful that we can smell them, and that along with seeing and hearing and touching and tasting, you have given us all these ways to learn more about your world and your creation. Thank you for your many gifts. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you, adults. So many gifts. So many gifts that join us every Sunday. So many gifts. All of you, such gifts. God is so generous. And we too can be generous because God has shown us how it's done. So there are so many ways, just as we have five senses, there are at least five ways we can be generous with our gifts. Now is the time when we ask you to be generous from your pocketbook. Thank you.
Thank you.
all praise and glory and thanksgiving. We ask that you lead us and guide us to discern how we can best be your hands, your feet, and your loving heart in a world of such desperate need. In your name we pray. Amen.
The gospel reading this morning is from John chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those who sat at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume, made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who later betrayed him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the gold given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and he would steal from it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She brought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you. Do you not always have me?" God is still speaking.
Let's pray. Lord God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations you place upon each of our hearts be acceptable in your eyes, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. They say that when it comes to remembering things, the sense that evokes the strongest, most vivid memories is the sense of smell. It seems that when we smell a familiar odor, it can transport us immediately right back to the situation when we first smelled that odor. It can remind us of a special person or a special place, even if it's been years. Now, my mother was an outstanding baker. She taught me well how to estimate measurements when I didn't have a teaspoon or a cup, and how to skip steps and dirty fewer dishes. When I was in about the sixth or seventh grade, Mom decided she was tired of spending money on bread, even thrift store bread. So she decided that she was going to bake our bread from now on. Now, this was long before anybody had dreamed up a bread machine. When Mom baked bread, it meant she started mixing up the dough in the morning and kneading it and leaving it to rise and tending to it every couple of hours. Usually around 1:30 or 2 o'clock, the bread finished its final rise and Mom would pop it in the oven to bake. By the time we got home from school, the whole house and sometimes the whole street, it seemed, smelled like fresh baked bread. Sometimes it was rye bread or wheat bread. On special weeks, it might be cinnamon swirl. We would walk in the door, take a deep breath, and float away on the fragrance like some cartoon character. It was wonderful. And plus, that smell of the baked bread masked some of the other odors generated in a house full of teenagers. Fragrances can be deep, deep reminders. And today in John's Gospel, we're reminded in advance that Jesus' time was drawing near, the time when all his followers would have left were poignant memories. Listen again to the passage, this time from Eugene Peterson's The Message. 6 days before Passover, Jesus entered Bethany, where Lazarus, so recently raised from the dead, was living. Lazarus and his sisters invited Jesus to dinner at their home. Martha served. Lazarus was one of those sitting at the table with the disciples. Mary came in with a jar of very expensive aromatic oils, anointed and massaged Jesus' feet, and then wiped them with her hair. And the fragrance of the oils filled the house. Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, even then getting ready to betray him, said, "Why wasn't this oil sold and the money given to the poor? It would easily have brought 300 pieces of silver." He said this not because he cared 2 cents about the poor, but because he was a thief. He was in charge of their common funds, but also embezzled from them. Jesus said, "Let her alone. She's anticipating and honoring the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you. You don't always have me." Here's Jesus enjoying time with his closest friends, so close they're practically family. The gathering is especially sweet because just a few days earlier, his beloved friend Lazarus was dead, sealed in a tomb, remember? And now here they are enjoying dinner together, celebrating Lazarus' rebirth, while Lazarus' sister Mary quietly enters the room. Imagine Mary kneeling before Jesus. Imagine as she breaks open the jar of nard and pours the entire thing, a full pint of expensive perfume, on Jesus' feet. I'm sure as the fragrance of nard filled the air, the guests gasped in surprise, overwhelmed by the scent typically associated with preparing a body and honoring the dead. What on earth was she thinking? They had come to celebrate Jesus' life, not worry about anyone's death. As if that wasn't enough, Mary didn't stop there. She loosened her hair from her neck, let it fall around her face, and proceeded to dry Jesus' feet with her hair. Now, folks, if you're not picking up on the raw sensuality of this passage, you are not paying attention. For a woman to place herself in such a position of humility and submission before men was simply not done, any more than it might be done today. Such a lavish display of affection was unheard of. And on top of all that, now in comes Judas the distractor, diverting attention from Mary's display of unbridled love for Jesus, and declaring in essence that Mary has just wasted a whole pint of expensive perfume, and for what? Jesus soundly rebukes him, but it's this next verse that has become one of many excuses the church often makes as to why we don't really need to reach out and work to eliminate poverty in the world. "You will not always have me with you," Jesus says, "but the poor are always with you." Now, it's been quite a while since I gave you a language lesson. Lucky, lucky you. Today is the day. Remember back in elementary school when you learned about the different moods or tenses of verbs? Do you remember learning about the indicative tense? The indicative tense is the one that is simply stating a fact or an occurrence, like, "Our choir sings beautifully every Sunday." Statement of fact. Simple enough, right? Yeah, I think it's true. But in the original Greek, this sentence about the poor appears to be such a simple statement of fact. But it's not that simple at all. Because in the Greek, the indicative form of the verb looks just the same as the imperative form. The imperative form is the command. "Choir, would you sing beautifully, please?" So it's the same, it looks the same, really, like "sing" and "sing." You may remember that. So what if Instead of Jesus simply stating a fact that the poor are always with you, Jesus instead is instructing his disciples, always keep the poor with you. Always keep the poor with you. Instead of shoving the poor and the broken and the unclean off to the sides, instead of averting your eyes as you walk past them, instead of praying for the light to turn green so you don't have to see the man holding the sign, bring them into the fold. If someone has a need and you can help eliminate that need, do so. And do so joyfully. Always keep the poor with you. If God's grace and goodness and forgiveness are available to you, are they not available to everyone? Embrace those in life's margins as Jesus has embraced you. Always keep the poor with you, Jesus taught. For in keeping them close, you keep Jesus close. Jesus reminds Judas that worldly things of value have little value in the kingdom of God. People matter. Everyday lives matter. Expensive perfume really doesn't matter so much at all. Keep the poor with you always. In other words, this verse that's been used to excuse the church from engaging problems in the world becomes a command to continue to do as Jesus did in his short life. Open the doors wide. Set the table with the finest food, not leftovers. Welcome everyone. Everyone. Funny, isn't it, that this passage would come around on a Sunday when we're preparing to celebrate Holy Communion together? There will always be someone who's trying to tell us who's in and who's out. But at the end of the day, it is Christ who welcomes. It is Christ whose life we come to celebrate. Our role in this party is simply to show up humbly before God, honoring God with our whole selves, body, mind, and spirit, and with our gifts without reservation, holding nothing back. Material wealth isn't what matters before the Lord. What matters are a pure, teachable heart and a humble, genuine spirit. Come to the table. You are welcome here. Amen. You've heard the words. You are welcome. Christ is the one who has set the table, and Christ is the one who decides who is welcome, and Christ has told us it's you. We'll come down the center aisle and return by the sides. We have bread. We have gluten-free wafers. We have grape juice in the chalices, and if you choose that option, you may dip your bread in the chalice by the method of intinction. We also have individual glasses of juice. If you cannot come forward or prefer to remain in your seat, raise your hand, and after all have been served, a server will bring you communion. The children are welcome. Jesus welcomed the children, and so do we. I simply ask as parents that you say a word to your children why this is an important experience for you that you want them to participate in. So I invite you now to take a moment and settle your hearts and prepare yourself for communion. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their wrongdoing and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and before one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread. And when he had given thanks to God, he broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, broken and given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup and again giving thanks to God, he passed it to all his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. Let us pray. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, Lord, and on these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the sharing of this juice, we may know the presence of the living Christ and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by Christ's blood until Christ comes again in final victory and we feast together at your table forever. Amen. The body of Christ, broken for you. The cup of the new covenant, shared and poured out for you. My servers, come forward, please. And it is a bounteous feast. Come as your spirit leads you.
Come on.
see. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. There's a group who still needs to be served. Forgive me. Stand together now and sing hymn number 407, God Has Spoken by His Prophets. All that is, and leading us into all that will be. That's a heck of a God, and for that we can all be grateful. As you go into the world, carry in your heart the steadfast eternity of which you are a part. Go in peace. Amen.